This morning, it is Palm Sunday, tradition of the church. We're entering into what's commonly referred to as Holy Week in preparation for Easter. I don't know how it comes so quick this year, but it just did. But it's Easter. And so I want to push into a subject today that will be difficult for some people. And I'm going to push into a subject and talk about suffering. And I'm in a moment where I'm kind of going, it's probably even in my entire life, I haven't gone through what I would consider significant levels of suffering. And so to talk about a subject of suffering, knowing that there are people here today that have gone through significantly harder suffering than I ever have and may ever will do. I acknowledge that this is an interesting subject. But as we look at the scriptures, as we look at the story in the Bible, you cannot avoid suffering. You cannot get away. You got people in the scriptures, stories of people that are suffering. The New Testament talks about the church and how they are meant to strengthen themselves against suffering. That suffering will come. And so we're going to talk about that today. One of the reasons I wanted to bring this up today is that when you read the scriptures, its view upon suffering is distinctly different than our cultural view in Australia in 2024 on suffering. We grow up, we're part of this culture, we adopt the values that are in the culture of today. But when you come to suffering, the view of our cultural view of suffering in Australia is distinctly different than the biblical view of suffering. And when this happens in Scripture and against our culture, it's difficult for us as Christians to get a good solid view of how we are meant to step into this space, of what we're meant to do in this area. There's often this tension between our cultural upbringing in this world and what we learn and understand as the scriptures. And so I want to bring up this today. You see, because generally, and I generalize today, that our cultural view upon suffering is to flee all forms of suffering. This is our cultural view, that flee from suffering, avoid it at all costs. Suffering is bad and all suffering is bad and we want to flee at all costs. That is generally our cultural view upon suffering in 2024. It's why topics like euthanasia and all that swirl around, pain management, and that's why the pharmaceutical companies in pain management are significantly large. They sell a lot of this stuff. And I don't want to push into a space to say this is good or this is bad, but I just want to present this is where we are at as a culture. This is where we are and this is what's happening. We need to acknowledge this space that we want to flee from all forms of suffering. Even in our greetings, we often want to avoid any conversation about someone having a rough week or a bad week. In our greetings, if someone says, "Oh, how are you going?" our instant reaction is to say good. Instant reaction. To get against that, we've got to actually think about saying something else. Even in our greetings, often we presume that the person is good already. You go, "Sharon, how are you going? Good?" You already presume that they're good, and they're probably likely not. I don't think there's anybody in this room today that says they haven't suffered or haven't gone through some level of suffering. Sometimes we go, "Oh yeah, but I'm going through suffering as bad as that person." But the acknowledgement in that space that you are actually still suffering, there is actually still some level of strain upon your life in some area that is difficult in that space. And so our cultural understanding is to avoid it at all costs. But what should our biblical perspective on suffering be? Should it be the same as the culture or should it be different? I want to lead you to 1 Peter chapter 4 today, if you've got your Bible there. And we're going to read and journey through this passage. 1 Peter 4, verse 1 and 2 says, "Therefore, since Christ suffered in his body, arm yourselves also with the same attitude, because whoever suffers in the body is done with sin. And as a result, they do not live the rest of their earthly lives for evil human desires, but rather for the will of God." I continue in verse 12. It says, "Dear friends, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that has come on you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice, inasmuch as you participate in the sufferings of Christ, so that you may be overjoyed when his glory is revealed. If you are insulted because of the name of Christ, you are blessed, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you. If you suffer, it should not be as a murderer or a thief or any kind of criminal, or even as a meddler. However, if you suffer as a Christian, do not be ashamed, but praise God that you bear that name. For it is time for judgment to begin with God's household. And if it begins with us, what will be the outcome for those who do not obey the gospel of God? And if it is hard for the righteous to be saved, what will become of the ungodly and the sinner? So then, those who suffer according to God's will should commit themselves to their faithful Creator and continue to do good." I'm sure many of you have actually read through this passage before and looked at this idea of suffering. And I think in Christian circles, we tend to put suffering in two kind of broad categories. One of those suffering categories is like the missionary martyr suffering category. It's that category where the missionaries go into a really rough place and they're suffering, they're living in squalor, and but they're sharing the gospel. They're sharing the gospel, they're striving. Maybe it's not in that level of extreme, but you go, "Yeah, I was persecuted because I was sharing the gospel. I was bearing the name of the gospel." Often we put it in that category and we kind of go, "Yeah, that suffering's fine. That's good suffering, because I was declaring the gospel. I was being a good Christian within that space and declaring in that area." Recently, a couple of weeks ago, and a friend of mine went overseas, and he took a few people from his church, and he come back, and they got put in jail because they were declaring the gospel. And often we'd look at that space and go, "Yeah, that was like good suffering. They're declaring the gospel." We see stories, in Paul when he's suffering for the gospel. We go, "Yeah, that's good suffering. That's all right, as Christians." And this is this missionary kind of martyr suffering space. But then we have this other category, which is this everyday suffering. Simply being part of this world and being in this space, whether it's sickness or just simple pain or whatever it is in this space, this everyday suffering. And it's this suffering, even as Christians, that we want to flee from at all costs. I'm not saying whether that's good or bad, but we want to flee from this. It's this level of pain. We take Nurofen if we're in a little bit of pain. We do and move into this space. Everyday suffering. And it's this level of suffering I want to push in to actually speak about today. This everyday suffering. You see, in the midst of this everyday suffering, sometimes as we look at the stories in the Bible, we elevate these saints, we elevate these people in the Bible actually to a really high standard that we could never achieve that level. We see and we put them in that missionary suffering space going, yeah, but they were doing that for the glory of God, they were doing that. But often a lot of those stories is just this everyday suffering. They're actually just struggling in that space. One of those, is Paul. Often we elevate Paul. He's written so many gospels in that space. But Paul, in the midst of that, he talks about this idea of having a thorn in his side. It's not necessarily he connects it with declaring the gospel, but it's something, it's not a physical thorn. He didn't just walk into a rose bush or something like that. But it's something that's impacting him. That's close. It's impacting his ministry. We actually don't know what it is. You know, many people have guessed what it is and look towards it. But there's something in the everyday that was impacting him, simply being a Christian, simply just doing the will of God. And we see that, we see that in guys like Job. We don't picture Job as this guy who's declaring the gospel and reaching converts. But in the everyday, we see that he gets attacked. In the everyday, we see that he goes through this space, a level of suffering. King David, we often elevate in that sort of space. But even then, in the midst of that, he had to avoid being killed, and he suffered for that space. There was a level of everyday suffering that he experienced. Joseph is another story as well. Sold into slavery by his brothers, suffered and killed. God used that in his will, but there was a level of everyday suffering that he also experienced. And we see in this space, even Adam and Eve. They decided and they went wrong. But something you don't realize in the story is that Adam and Eve, they had two sons, Cain and Abel. One son killed the other son. How awful as parents would that be? There's heartbreak and suffering that they went through, in the everyday. None of these seem to be missionaries that were kind of, apart from Paul, that was kind of martyred for their faith in that sort of space. Yet as followers of God, they suffered. They went through a level of strain and heartache in that space. And the Bible doesn't kind of avoid it and say, maybe because they did wrong, or maybe because they live in this evil world that, they should avoid it at all costs. They should run away from it, like our culture does. It actually seems to just push into that story and into that space. So what should our biblical perspective on suffering be? This passage in 1 Peter chapter 4 acknowledges that suffering, that there will be suffering for believers, that there will be strain upon our life. It doesn't avoid it. We are not absent of suffering. It even uses the words participate in the sufferings of Christ. Now, often when we read that passage, we go to the martyr sort of die, dying for your faith. But it's also applied to the everyday suffering and everyday strain. And there's a phrase in here. It says to say this, have the same attitude of Christ. And in that attitude, whoever suffers in the body is done with sin. Whoever suffers in the body is done with sin. This has grabbed me this week as I've kind of prepared this space. And we'll go back to this, but think about that. But in the midst of this suffering, it acknowledged that there is suffering in the consequences of our sin. There is suffering in the consequences of evil. Peter's pretty clear in this passage. He says, if you suffer, it should not be as a murderer or a thief or any type of criminal or even a meddler in that space, even somebody who meddles. That's a different form of suffering that Peter is not referring to in this space. There's judgment for that suffering. So Peter's not saying rejoice in that suffering, but he is saying rejoice in this everyday suffering as a follower of Jesus. Now, that's easy to say, but that's hard to actually do. And so why does he say this? Why does he say this? There's an opportunity in the midst of our suffering, in the midst of our heartache, to actually declare the glory of God, to present the glory of God, to present that in the midst of the fact that we haven't got everything together, in the midst of the fact that we are actually straining, we are actually struggling, I know that God is still faithful. I know that God has still saved me. I know that God has still redeemed me in the midst of that. And that is an incredibly powerful message to the world in which we live, in the midst of my suffering. It's even greater when we look at verse 1, where actually declares that whoever suffers in the body is done with sin. Suffering, whoever suffers in this physical space, you know, has made an intentional decision to avoid sin. So it's not saying in that space that if you sin, that you will suffer because of your sin. It's actually because you have taken the attitude to avoid sin, you will still suffer in that space. You see, sometimes when we hear the gospel of God, sometimes when we present the kingdom of God, we present it in a viewpoint on this earth that there is no suffering. We present it in a viewpoint that, okay, once you become a follower of Jesus, it's going to be amazing. You know, it's going to be so good. And that is correct. But also in the midst of that, there is going to be suffering. In the midst of that, there is going to be strains and there is going to be heartache. We cannot avoid this. This is something that is part of being a follower of Jesus as a result of the world in which we're in. There will be a day when there is no more pain, when there is no more suffering, and that's when we experience the fullness of the heaven, of the kingdom of God. But this day, in this space, there is still suffering. And in the midst of that, we actually are in a space where we can grow and we can look closer to Jesus. So the commitment in the gospel is that you will not, is not the fact that you'll avoid all suffering, but the commitment that we see even in the Great Commission, that Jesus declares and he says, I will be with you always to the very end of the earth. The commitment that in the midst of the suffering, that I will be with you. That is, Jesus will be with you in the midst of that. And God has gifted his church to journey alongside you in the midst of that suffering. Not to avoid it at all costs, but to actually sit with it in that space. That in fact, some suffering is actually beneficial as it draws you closer to God. It grabs your attention. It recognizes in that space that you are a follower of Jesus. And in fact, not all suffering is actually bad for us. Now, it's difficult. I can't categorize suffering. I don't have that level of authority or that level of knowledge to say that's good suffering or that's bad suffering or that's, that's in the good space as well. All I have is the midst is to journey with you in the suffering and to be praying for you, to be asking God into that space. And sometimes that midst of suffering will help us grow. The image I get, when I speak about suffering, when I think about suffering, is the image of our body and the muscle system in our body. Now, for a muscle to grow in our body, and I'm no expert in this space, but for a muscle to grow, you actually have to put it under a level of strain in order to strengthen it. If you decide one day that I'm no longer going to walk, I'm no longer going to put my muscles or anything under any level of strain, you'll probably find by the end of the year that you're quite weak, that you're quite brittle, that you've probably lost all level of strength and all level of muscle mass. In order to become strong, your body under a level of strain, a level of strength. And I can't help that God does this in our faith as well. That God allows us in that space to go through some levels of suffering in order to strengthen our faith, in order to speak into other people's lives and declare the goodness of God in the midst of your suffering. You see, we have a culture of people going to the gym. I go to the gym with a bunch of guys there at night and in the midst of that, this is very heavy. Yeah. If I'm actually going to strengthen my muscles in the midst of that, I have to put it under a level of strain and under a level of suffering. Yeah, it's 35 kilos. It's quite heavy. Yeah, I picked it up from Spencer's place this morning, and I'm probably hitting a point of suffering already in the midst of this. But if I continued every Monday, maybe a few other days each week, to continually to strengthen my body, to continually work up into this space, I could potentially by the end of the year just lift this with a level of ease. If I continued to strengthen my body, it's going to be a little bit of pain in that space. There's going to be a level of strain that I'm put through. But in the midst of that, there will be strength. And I think that God uses suffering in that way. I need to put that down. God uses suffering in that area. This everyday suffering, we can actually use that to strengthen our faith. Yeah. In order to declare the goodness of God in that space. But we're not alone in this space. You know, 1 Peter says, therefore, since Christ suffered in his body, arm yourselves with the same attitude. In the midst of this, we follow after the example of Christ. Christ went through various forms of suffering that we celebrate and acknowledge in this Holy Week. The suffering that Christ went through so that we could be saved, so that we can have life in him. And Jesus calls us to have that same level of attitude, the same attitude that Jesus has in suffering. Not avoid at all costs attitude that our culture has, but to push into that, to seek God. You see, even in the midst of the Garden of Gethsemane on Good Friday, Jesus asks if there is another way, if he could avoid suffering. That shows his level of humanness in that space. And that's exactly what we do in that space. We don't want to go through a level of suffering, and that's okay. But in the midst of that space, he submits to the will of God. In the midst of that space, he understands that this suffering is required and it's needed. Because whoever suffers in the body is done with sin. If we avoid suffering at all cost, if we avoid it with anything, sometimes we will actually avoid the opportunities that God has in this life. We'll actually avoid the opportunities that God has to witness in this life. I'm always encouraged as either I go up to the hospital or I experience people who are suffering some significant spaces. Always encouraged by their faith. We have had two people in particular, and in the last kind of few months that have gone through some significant level of suffering through cancer and through Parkinson's. And I'm encouraged that in the midst of that, which I would struggle through and I would, it would be difficult. In the midst of that, they're looking for the opportunities that God has. In the midst of that, they're rejoicing in their sufferings. Their faith is strong and their faith is strengthening. And that is an example of what Peter invites us to in this everyday suffering. Whoever suffers in the body is done with sin. Verse 19, he says, so then, those who suffer according to God's will should commit themselves to the faithful Creator and continue to do good. Commit ourselves to the faithful Creator and continue to do good. So in the midst of your suffering, in the midst of your strain today, this is what the Scripture is calling you to, is to commit to God in the midst of that. Commit to God and what God is doing in that space. I'm going to allow you to have a moment in your seat and just to pray with God. We're going to have a minute and just to pray with God. And in the midst of whatever you're going through today, I encourage you to commit yourself to God, saying, God, I am for you. I am with you. Help me through this. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you. We thank you in the midst of our suffering, Lord, that you are there. That you are there to journey with us. You've gifted your church to journey with us as well. Lord, we don't like suffering, Lord. It's tough and it's difficult in that space. Lord, our natural reaction is to avoid it at all costs. But Lord, help us instead to push into you. Yeah, to continue to commit to you every single day in the midst of our suffering, in the midst of our strain, in the midst of our strife. Yeah, allow us to push into that space and declare your glory today. Amen.